Welcome back to Armchair Directors. We are at Steve's Movie World in Kitchener, which is fitting because we're going to take a look at two old video releases, DVD and Blu-ray, two Marvel movies. Spider-Man is a Marvel movie. We're going to keep the Marvel theme going with two movies that were kind of duds.
Didn't light up the box office, that's for sure.
No, but they're not bad movies at all, or they're not completely bad. We're going to start off with The Punisher, starring Thomas Jane and John Travolta, which I have really mixed feelings about because I am a huge Punisher fan. He is probably my favorite Marvel superhero.
Yeah.
Superhero. He doesn't really... If he has a superpower, it's hate. That's how he survives the things that the Saint family do to him in this movie. And they've taken three cracks at it. There's three Punisher movies that are all reboots. The original one with Dolph Lundgren, which didn't really have much in common with the comic. And then there's this one that really changed a lot of things, but I don't hold it against him because the people making this movie had no budget. They couldn't even shoot it in New York or a place that looked like New York. They had to shoot it in Tampa, Florida, which doesn't exactly say mob, crime-ridden, you know, mean streets. And then there's the Ray Stevenson Punisher Warzone, which Thomas Jane dropped out of just because he seems like a guy with, you know, quite a bit of integrity. And he wrote this great long post on Ain't It Cool News before dropping out of Warzone or after dropping out, saying he just couldn't be in it knowing how bad the script was. And he really was passionate and crazy about the character. He loved it. He wrote some of the comics of the Punisher. The director's cut, which is this right here, unfortunately not available on Blu-ray, but if you can find the old DVD, they actually shot a new intro for the movie, which they didn't have the budget, again, to shoot for the original movie, of Frank Castle in Kuwait with his old buddy Jimmy Weeks. And so they took still photographs and really animated it beautifully. And it's a great way to start the movie with Frank Castle kicking butt with a shotgun and attack vest. So much better than the original version starts.
Yeah, and basically, this version does start, it sort of feels like a comic book when it opens, so it's fitting that, you know, this is a comic book movie, right?
Yeah.
Definitely better than the first scene of the theatrical version.
Otto Creed.
We've got Thomas Jane wearing, like, this horrible blonde hair wig, doing this awful accent.
He's undercover.
At a weapons deal that goes wrong.
Yeah, he's undercover as a drug dealer. And it's just so not in the essence of the character, because Frank Castle isn't he's not underhanded, he's not a liar, he's not a coward, and that just all seems very slimy and sneaky, and not in the vein of the character.
And a really poorly planned undercover operation, where his character is supposed to get shot on purpose to fake his death, but of course it leads to other gunfire that ends up resulting in the death of Saint's son. So John Travolta's son dies, and John Travolta wants to get revenge, and he finds out that this guy, Frank Castle, is alive, and he's actually an undercover officer who's now gone away, so he orders his whole family murdered.
Yeah, so one of the changes they had to do, the original Punisher comic, Frank Castle is a Vietnam vet, comes home, and his wife and kid, one kid, killed in Central Park, I think, during a mob shootout. They just wrong place, wrong time. And that's what sparks this Punisher persona for Frank Castle, to punish all the evil men in the world who are responsible for what happened to him. So they didn't want to go that route because a Vietnam vet would be the age of Sylvester Stallone, right? So they put him in the Kuwait War instead, which isn't as intense and heartbreaking and all that stuff. And then they make him an FBI agent, and then they set it in Florida. And then when his family gets massacred, it's his whole family. Like 50 castles at a family reunion.
And watching Roy Scheider go out like that just made me angry.
Well, I loved it. I thought it was awesome that Roy Scheider, like Frank Castle Sr.'s last act in life, was saving his son's life by stabbing another guy. I thought it was cool.
Chief Brody dies on a beach? Are you kidding me?
Well, you got to keep in mind the budget again. They probably could afford Roy Scheider for literally 1 hour.
Yeah, a day.
Yeah, exactly. Get him in, get him out, and that's it. But this movie, there are some parts that are bad. But, you know, I just say, get through them. Suffer through them. Endure through them, because there are some parts in this movie that are really, really good. There's scenes like when Quentin Glass who's torturing Spacker Dave, played by the amazing Ben Foster, who's got all these piercings. He's ripping these piercings out.
Yeah.
Which is just a horrible scene. But before the piercings even start getting pulled out, that scene is so brilliantly written and acted. It is so intense that even though this is kind of a bad movie, it's one of those scenes that shuts everybody up in the room and you're just drawn in and you can cut the tension with a knife. Mm. There's a couple scenes like that. So it's a really strange movie. There's some really cheesy parts. Frank and his wife during the family reunion, the dialogue is so atrocious. We are not lucky. We are blessed. So that stuff is eye-rolling. Yeah. But then there's some really intense stuff. Like Jane just owns it in this one.
Well, and Jane is really good, and he does get some really intense moments, and I really like that stuff. And John Travolta eats the scenery. He's just over the top, out of control, crazy John Travolta, right?
Yeah, he's like the Batman movie. Tommy Lee Jones is Two-Face. He's just like, all of it!
Right, and I really like Will Patton as like his right-hand man. I thought that guy was good, too. Yep. But this is like an R-rated movie that half the time doesn't really go for the R rating. You feel like they're pulling back, and maybe it was just budget.
Yeah.
That, like, people are just getting shot, and there's not very realistic violence. And then the action scenes are a little bit cheesy sometimes, where, like, the wife and the kid get in the car, and they're going, and the boat is attached! Oh, no, the boat is attached!
Yeah.
And the music in that scene just drives me crazy. It sounds like Peter and the Wolf from the Disney animated thing. You've got, like, this guy trying to be Morricone, like you said, and just not quite nailing it. So there's a lot of times where I thought the music undercut the tension and the excitement of the action because it's just a really weird score. Now, there are other parts later in the movie where the score does work.
It's hit and miss.
Right. So it's not all terrible, but like there are some moments where I was just like, what am I hearing right now?
Yeah, and they really wanted that Morricone sound because they wanted to make a Western, and there's a lot of people... my good friend Steve Casson, for one, who points out, you know, the first time I watched this movie, I didn't like it. And then when I watched it again, realizing it's a Western, mm-hmm. I loved it. It is a Western. It's like an old Eastwood revenge flick.
Well, and I really like the part that feels the most like the Western, where the assassin comes into the cafe and sings Frank Castle that song. And then, you know, they have their showdown.
Yeah.
And that's one of those bizarre, like, awesome moments of this movie, right?
It captures your attention.
And you need more moments like that. And less Rebecca Romaine and that other awful dude who lives in that building.
I love those guys.
I like Ben Foster.
Bumpo and Spacker Dave.
But Bumpo and Rebecca Romaine are just eating up screen time for no reason. The whole subplot where Castle tries to make Saint think that his wife is cheating on him with his right-hand man who's actually gay.
Yeah.
There's just a little bit too much corn happening in this movie.
They wanted Frank in this movie to be more like he is in the comics. He's not all about putting a bullet in your head. He's about that psychological warfare and that psychological torture.
Mm-hmm.
Like, really punishing. It's all about the punishment. Death is too easy for these scum, is Frank Castle's motto. And so that's where they were going with the fake fire hydrant. And
right.
It's just such a weird transition at one point where Frank has had the stuffing beat out of him by the Russian, who is an amazing villain.
Right.
A lot of cool characters from the comic that they just
show up,
mashed in this. And he's just had the stuffing beat out of him, and he's cut, and he's beat up, and he gets up, and he looks at what they did to poor Dave with all his piercings torn out, and he goes, they're going to pay. And he goes and grabs his fire hydrant, and he makes a phone call from a car and parking tickets. Like, it's just... That probably could have been shortened. Get that bow and arrow and that double barrel shotgun out sooner.
Because that stuff, I'm just like, what? And then I'm sure that on paper they were like, at the end of the movie, there's going to be all this fire and explosions, and it's going to make the Punisher symbol, and it's going to be incredible.
Like the Crow.
And then it happens, and I'm like, are you for real? What? Is this, why would this happen? Why would this be something that Frank would do? Like, yeah. I just...
Well,
and it doesn't even look that good.
Joan says at one point, maybe he's an artist, so, you know.
Performance art.
Sometimes, you know, when you go through horrible things like Frank has, your creativity can save you. But, you know, a lot of people think this movie is so violent and horrible, but I honestly do find it to be an inspirational movie. You know, Frank just goes through something that is so, so awful. And, you know, he becomes an alcoholic and he's suicidal at one point. But what I find inspirational is that he keeps going, and it's kind of a simple motto, but it is a military motto, Charlie Mike, which stands for continue mission. You've got this guy who's, you know, it's to the point of being ridiculous. I mean, his whole family, like extended family, distant cousins, they're
all
dead.
What a bad weekend to have a family reunion.
And you just literally continue mission, like just grab that gun and continue mission. And his mission is to avenge his family and get rid of the Saints. And what I think is kind of cool and inspirational in a strange Punisher way is that when he does wipe out the Saints and he goes to finally kill himself, some people think that scene is great. Some people think it's ridiculous with the quivering lip. But and he can't do it because he realizes his mission isn't over. It wasn't just about wiping out the Saints. It's about wiping out all people like the Saints who take it too far, who, you know, like Frank says in his little final speech. And I love how the movie ends. It's just too bad that we never got another Thomas Jane Punisher, because this really felt like a great prequel, a ramp up to a movie that never was.
Yeah.
The real Thomas Jane Punisher movie. I think throughout this whole movie, he's not the Punisher. He's only the Punisher in like the last 10 minutes.
10 minutes.
Yeah.
Time for best part.
Worst part. So I'm going to go best part is Thomas Jane, hands down. He just owns it in this movie. This movie for me is a lot like Escape from LA. You've got this really crap movie with this amazing, cool main character, Snake Plissken. Same thing here. Some of the parts of this movie are bad, but Thomas Jane is so cool, so amazing, sometimes so cold. He's got like a sly sense of humor. I love the deleted scene in the extended cut with Frank and Jimmy Weeks where he makes Jimmy kill himself. I thought that there was nothing in the movie that really captured the comic Punisher more than that scene, where instead of just putting a bullet in his in the head of his friend who gave him up, he actually makes his friend kill himself because his friend is sick and he needs his help.
Yeah.
Shame that got cut, but I know why that it got cut. That actor who plays Jimmy Weeks, really not the best. And if you've got to shave a half hour out of the movie, that was the easy call. Worst part is that scene between Frank and his wife, the We Are Blessed thing. But then there's like a few other things with like the Saints, you know, some of the Saint goons. You're supposed to think that they're these big, nasty guys, but they only have like 10 seconds of screen time. You know, like the shootout. A lot of people love the three-way shootout in the basement of the Saint Towers, but I just really don't care because who are these guys?
Right.
These two bald guys who are wearing long coats and they get blown away. I don't care.
I'm going to go worst part. So I'm not a fan of the direction of this movie. I think like you gave it to anybody else, it probably could have been a little bit better.
That's all they could afford.
And basically he also wrote the movie, Jonathan Hensley, and like the script, sometimes I needed a rest because I was rolling my eyes so much. So worst part, that, and the music at some points just killed it for me. Just killed it for me. Best part, obviously Thomas Jane. And even when Thomas Jane is doing sort of goofier things like the popsicle and the steak, but those scenes are like funny and they work because it's Jane, right? He really takes it seriously. He does a great job. So overall, Thomas Jane, easily the best part, and makes this movie worth checking out. Now, I wish that this extended cut was available on Blu-ray, and I'm sure one day it will. The current version of Punisher on Blu-ray is horrible. It looks worse than a DVD.
Oh, no.
So if you don't have it, don't get it.
Yeah. So in that case, try to find that director's cut, because that intro and the Jimmy Weeks extra storyline doesn't bog the movie down at all. I think it really adds a lot to it. It's great to start a Punisher movie with Frank kicking butt. And a really big thing for me is when the original cut ends and Frank gives that speech on the bridge, they cut to that Step Up song, the death metal Step Up.
Yeah.
In the extended version, there's like comic-looking animated bullets instead, and they play that song by Harry Heck in time. So it's more in, you know, with the tone of the bridge scene. It's quiet, it's brooding, it's like the bad guys are in big trouble because the Punisher is born.
For sure.
So it seems like the extended cut, it wasn't just something a studio mashed together to make a quick buck. More than a lot of extended cuts I've seen, this one seems like a lot of passion went into it. And a lot of broken hearts that were disappointed that they didn't get to work on a proper Thomas Jane sequel, so they put all of their effort into the extended cut.
For sure. And speaking of passionate director's cuts, we will be back with a look at Ben Affleck in Daredevil.
Clearly, Stevenson.
Jane.
Stevenson.
Jane.
Stevenson.
Jane.
Stevenson.
Jane.
Stevenson.